Okay, welcome to IT Idiots, episode 38, I believe.
Yep.
My name's Nicholas Hill, and joined, as always, by the very knowledgeable Nikki Curtis. This week we're going to be looking at RAID and NAS, I believe.
Yeah.
Did I get that right?
You did, yeah.
I only asked you about half a dozen times.
You did, yeah.
I think I've got a memory problem. So, yes, that sounds all rather interesting. So what have you got planned then?
Right, what we're going to do is, well, we had a few forum posting about free NAS.
Okay.
We're not going to look at FreeNAS because we picked another one called OpenFiler. So that's in the second half of the show. But we're going to start off with just going through basic RAID and having a look at what Windows Server can do in software. So looking at software RAID. Not that I know anyone who uses it. However, you will need to know it for your exam, and it's a good way to start off describing RAID 0, 1, and 5.
Oh, can we... let's do this first before we get into anything that's boring. Well, sorry, I mean relevant. Look what I got. Look, it's a helicopter. I need to get it down so the camera can see it. And that's the other nice thing about this little remote helicopter. It doesn't seem to break. There we go.
It was an accident. So, basically...
That's that then.
I bring technical content and you bring pornographic cakes and helicopters.
Yeah. Oh, yes, our new sponsor. Yeah, yeah. So I'll try and put some banners up and stuff.
Yeah, if you to see how many other people you can offend.
Yeah, if you want to support the show... No, that's not true. I had an email from somebody who will remain anonymous, but one of our bigger contributors.
And he said... I was going to go out and rape someone until I found your cakes. And
no, he said that the cake idea was brilliant. It combined his two favourite hobbies, which was eating cake and pornography.
Yeah, I think you tell me who that was, actually.
I won't mention it, but you know who you are. Yeah. So no, I've had a couple of other choice emails, sort of people who have found it rather amusing. So they're our new sponsor. If you want to sponsor us and get us some money...
What about your parents? So what do they think of this?
They think it's a great idea.
Do they?
They do.
Your mum especially, yeah.
She's particularly happy and comfortable with the whole thing.
My dad said, oh, the website's looking different, and I have to quickly gloss over how Nick's doing some porn thing. Anyhow.
So right. That was comfortable conversation with your dad, was it?
Yeah, we just completely...
I didn't realise he still looked.
Occasionally he does, yeah.
Oh, occasionally. I wouldn't have done it otherwise. Okay.
Okay, so RAID, what does it stand for, Nick?
RAID.
What does RAID stand for?
I think it stands for when you go and attack something.
No. Right, so we're looking at disk. We're going to start off by looking at software RAID, and we're looking at the versions of RAID which Windows 2003 Server handles totally in software, and that'll be RAID 0, RAID 1, okay. And RAID 5. Okay. But the first thing we ought to do is just really define what RAID is.
I was going to say, what is RAID?
What is RAID? Excellent, Nate. Good co-host. redundant array of... independent disks, have you heard that before? Redundant array of independent disks? Or redundant array of inexpensive disks? That's how I learnt it anyway. I think they've changed the I for inexpensive. But what it's about having some kind of fault tolerance on your disks. So if one disk dies, then the other one can take its place. And the most fundamental form of RAID is mirroring, which you've probably heard of before.
Yeah.
And can you guess what mirroring is?
I guess where it takes one set of data and it mirrors it onto a...
Exactly.
Data. There's all sorts, aren't there? There's stripe, isn't there?
There's your cake business thing going on again.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay, so what I'm going to do, and this is something which is really great if you're running VMware, so I'm running VMware Workstation, you can do this in Virtual PC or VMware Server, is I'm just going to, before I fire up the virtual machine, I've just got a Windows Server configured, I'm just going to add to it multiple hard disks. Create new virtual hard disk, SCSI phone, and I'm just going to add a few more because when we fire this up, I want it to see all these disks and then we can look at software RAID on them.
Oh, you had a post yesterday. Do you want to see, whilst you're actually playing with the virtual machine, it's kind of relevant. Somebody was asking about the 120-day trial and taking snapshots and how they work in terms of your license, sort of the 120-day trial being able to reuse that.
It's a tough one, isn't it? Because you put your trial license key in, don't you, as you build it.
So snapshotting it...
Yeah, snapshotting it. I think it goes from the time you install it.
Right.
I've heard loads of things about people putting the time into the future, putting the clock or date into 2008, let's say, installing it and then rolling it back. And I think you might be able to do strange things like that.
Not that we condone or endorse any of this, but it was just a question. I thought you might be able to just answer it.
Yeah, it's a tough one. But, I mean, to be honest, with a 120-day trial, you'll probably find you're reinstalling it every 2 months. I don't think I had a virtual machine that's lasted more than 2 months.
Right.
Anyway, let's add some more hard disks. So that's the nice thing about VMware. We can try all of this. So it's got one hard disk for the operating system and three additional ones. That'd be enough, I think. of our resource issues, and let's just start this up.
We had a request for small business server as well. Did you see that one?
I didn't see that one, actually.
Yeah, somebody wants us to cover small business server.
Don't like that product.
Oh, I see. You recommend it for my company and install it, and now you've decided that it's not suitable.
Right. So we're going to have a look at Windows Server now. Windows Server, what we will be able to do is, it does support various different RAID levels. While it's booting up, actually, let's just go through Notepad and do the different versions of RAID, or the different levels of RAID which supports. Run. Notepad.
I paid.
And I shall put the right font on. That'll do.
Is that the font you spent half an hour picking out?
No.
It was.
So RAID 1.
Okay.
Is mirroring. So with mirroring you need two disks.
Yep.
Okay, two disks obviously, it writes to one, that information is mirrored on the second disk. Yep. Now when Windows is doing this in software, literally your Windows Server is writing to one and it's synchronizing to the other. So it's doing a lot more work.
So the overhead's quite a lot,
which is why no one uses software mirroring. Right. What you do, you use it in hardware. So in the BIOS you configure mirroring, but to the server it only thinks there's one
writing
hard disk.
One disk.
Yep. So it's writing once and the hardware is actually writing twice. So that's why you wouldn't generally do it in software. But RAID 1 is mirroring. Some people call it duplexing as well. Now, duplexing is slightly different. I don't know if you remember this.
No, telephones.
Well, mirroring, if you've got two hard disks, one fails, you've still got the other one.
Yeah.
So fine, happy with that one. But if the controller fails, it takes down both the hard disks.
Right.
So what duplexing is it's mirroring hard disks which are on different controller cards.
Okay.
Yeah, so eliminating the single point of failure.
And if one goes down, it automatically would kick in with the other one.
Exactly, yeah. So that's it. Another bad thing about software RAID is you find as one hard disk goes down, it actually locks the operating system up a lot of the time. So, but still, you've got your data nice and safe.
I'll type it into the password box.
Like that, innit?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Handy guy to have around, aren't you? Right, so I'm just logging onto the server, and the first thing I'm going to do is just fire up Disk Manager.
Quit.
And there's plenty of questions on this one in your MCSE, so other things you can do, you can mirror your operating system drive.
Okay.
Give yourself some fault tolerance on that, so if your operating system drive fails, you can still boot up from the other mirror. Now, various different ways of getting to disk management, and what I'm going to do is just right-click on my computer and go to Manage.
Do you want to just make that, you can full screen within this one, or is you going to be doing a lot of switching
around? It's
going
to be, this is fine for the Mac. And if I go into Disk Management here, it should recognise that it's found a few more disks. So it's found disk 1, 2, and 3.
Yep.
Do you want to initialize those? Yep. Do you want to convert them to dynamic disks? And I'm going to say yes to that.
Cool.
Right, so new to 2003, you have the concept of basic disks and dynamic disks.
Okay.
Everything under, I said new to 2003, it's actually in 2000. But everything prior to 2000, you can assume is on a basic disk.
Mm-hmm.
Everything on 2003 can be either basic or dynamic. But if you want to support any fault tolerant volumes, like you want to mirror,
mm-hmm.
or some of the other stuff we haven't talked about yet, you would need to be dynamic disks. So you can see here I've got my three dynamic disks. So the first thing we'll do is I'll just right click on that and say new volume. Click on next. And the different types of volumes we've got a mirrored volume. So let's just click on that one first. So the mirrored volume, I can choose space on disk 1 and 2, so it's going to mirror on disk 1 and 2,
mm-hmm.
see that? And let's just make a nice little small mirror there, 100 megabytes. Assign it E, next. Again, straightforward formatting, so format it with NTFS.
Defaults,
yeah, and we'll do a quick format on that.
Done.
And now we can see.
Oh, okay. There we go, and healthy.
We've got the mirrors then there,
yeah.
And that would be accessed by Drive E, and it really is as simple as that. Now, I suppose what I could do is go down to the host machine and make one of the disk files read-only, and perhaps we'll play around with that.
Okay, yeah.
Could play around with that, actually. There's some of the other things you can do on the disk system in 2003. If I create a new volume, a simple volume just takes up space on one drive, on one physical drive. So if I create a simple volume on drive one, let's make this 150 megabytes. And we'll give it drive letter F, format that, click on next and finish that. And we can see now on disk one I've got drive letter F, it's 150 megabytes. Now what I can write what I can do then is right click and extend that volume.
Right.
Say, well, you know, I didn't give it enough space. My database on it is taking up all the space. I can extend it.
Yeah.
But the other cool thing is that what you can do, you can extend it onto the other disks.
Wow, that starts to get confusing from a management point of view there, doesn't it?
It does a little bit. So if you look now, what I've got, and if I actually highlight this, you can see it's highlighting the one down the bottom as well.
Mm.
So this is all together. Now, benefits of that, well, what are the benefits?
Honestly, what you've just done, I can't see any.
Well, it could just be you've created the volume, it's on one disk,
you've got a database,
you don't have any space. So you bought yourself another physical drive and you can expand out onto that physical drive. But the trouble now is if you lose any one of those physical components,
the whole lot, or just three,
you've lost the whole lot.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, but you might be able to use some third-party data recovery to get that back.
Yeah.
So that's going through simple volumes, mm-hmm. Also span volumes, and also mirrored volumes. Okay, let's create another one. Let's right-click, new volume. Click on next. And the next thing we can do is create a striped volume. Now, striped volume, you need two disks. Or at least two disks. And the way this works is it creates a volume, but it stripes the data across the three physical disks. So if you imagine you've got two or three disks, it actually writes a chunk to that disk, then to that one, then to that one, then to that one, then to that one, and then to that one. The benefits of that is speed. So we've got multiple read-write heads writing for us.
Okay.
And imagine having one disk, and you're writing to one disk with one read-write head. Well, now you've got three dots of disks and you've got three read-write heads, so it's all about speed.
Yes.
But the downside, again, is if you lose one of those components, you've lost the whole lot.
Oh, okay. Because I always thought that with the three, as you said, from any two, you could rebuild the third one.
Well,
that's not true.
What I just described was something quite specific, and that's called striping, and that's RAID 0.
Okay.
RAID 0. I think 0, no fault tolerance.
Yeah.
Striping doesn't give you any fault tolerance at all.
Just
what it does is it gives you speed and performance.
Because you can read and write at the same time.
Exactly. And across multiple heads
as
well. Different to spanning, because spanning is you're using up space on one disk, then moving to the next disk, then moving to the next disk.
Yeah, sure.
Striping, you've designed it and you're striping across all those physical disks.
Yeah.
So that's RAID 0. Mirroring is RAID 1, and we've seen that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the things you might have come across is RAID 10. Now, RAID 10 is a bit of a weird one. We don't support RAID 10 in software in Windows 2003. But the benefit of RAID 0, remember what 0 is, it's striping, is speed.
Yeah.
What's the downside?
It's
fault tolerance. So why don't we get that RAID 0 and we mirror it, and what's that? It's RAID 1
and 0.
Plus 0, RAID 1 plus 0,
RAID 10.
So that's where RAID 10 comes from. It's basically a mixture of mirrored stripe.
Okay.
But we do have another one, and that's RAID 5.
I was going to say, that's the one I've heard of the most.
Now, what I'm going to do is just break this mirror now.
You want to just back up the data that you put on there?
Oh no, it's this one, isn't it?
But not that one. You click on the little one and then do it from there.
Let's delete volume here. Because with a stripe, RAID 0, you get performance, but your operating system drive can't be part of RAID 0.
No.
Not in software anyway,
okay.
But it would in hardware.
Yeah.
But the next one to have a look at is RAID 5. So if I create a new volume next, we get an option to create a RAID 5 volume.
Okay.
Now, RAID 5 volume, you need between 3 and 32 physical hard disks. And this is like what you were just talking about. What we do is we use one of those disks, or we stripe data across those three disks, but we use one of the disks. No, we don't use one of the disks. What you do, three disks, RAID 5, is you write data, parity, parity, data, data, parity.
So you're
striping parity information across those three disks.
Yeah.
If you've got four disks, then you're striping data across all those four disks.
And the parity shifts from disk to disk to disk.
Exactly, yeah. And with RAID 5, you can tolerate one failure.
Yeah.
Okay, so with mirroring, if you think about the overhead with mirroring, it's 100%, isn't it?
Yes.
To mirror 8 gig, we need another 8 gig. RAID 5, to mirror 5 drives, we need one fifth of the additional storage space. Let's use RAID 5. But we can only lose one disk.
You lose more than one disk, you're screwed.
Exactly. Okay. Now, most of the time, this is all done in hardware. You wouldn't tend to do that. So let's have a bit of a play around, actually, whilst we're in here. Let's do RAID 5. And we'll have it on all of the disks. Well, you don't have much choice. And let's put that as 150.
Okay, so our drive F is now
So drive F we've got, and we've also got, I don't know what drive letter this is.
E.
Change drive letter. So E and F's are fairly fault tolerant now, aren't they?
Yes.
Right, so that's basically discs now. What I'm going to do, let's just go to Explorer. And go to some of these mirror drives. I mean, you wouldn't notice from here.
No.
And it's just create some new documents in there. I'm doing that. And go to F. And let's create another WordPad document in here.
There are 0 bytes in size there.
It doesn't matter.
Won't make a difference.
Doesn't matter, no. So I've just put something in those drives. And I haven't actually planned to do this bit, but I think what we'll do next is we'll go to the VMware host machine.
Yeah.
And we'll make disk 2 read-only. just to see how that... I mean, what we're trying to do is simulate a failure.
Failure.
Okay, so disk 2, we should be able to lose that, shouldn't we?
Yep.
In fact, disk 1 or disk 2.
Yep.
Right, okay. Well, I didn't get very far with that one, did I? So, virtual machines, WD Lab, it was on my server. Right, so it's got to be one of these we created.
So
it's got to be that one, surely. That's got to be disk 1 that's created at 1620.
Yeah, so if you make that read-only.
Oh, you're not like that, mate. Let's make that one read-only. I think I've got the right file here. I hope I haven't got the... Oh, no, that's the wrong file. that's the operating system drive.
Yeah, you might want to...
So okay. I think, let's go into here and say they're healthy. I have a think not. Let's try storing some data on it. Gods.
Give yourself a full screen, treat yourself.
So I've just created some documents, actually, so you can see it's all working still. I was kind of hoping that Disk Manager might start moaning. This one in here. So what I'm going to do...
But if it's trying to write the disk, you would have thought now it would have complained when you tried to...
It's trying to write to it, yeah. Unless what VMware's done behind the scenes is created another disk file. So I made that one read-only, didn't I?
Log file.
No, I don't know. Well, that here endeth the disk lesson anyway.
Here endeth the disk lesson. That's good. You've used up about half your time.
Have I?
Maybe a tad more.
Well, there you go.
Well, in the real world, to prove it, we could go just rip a drive out.
This is true, yeah. We don't have that. Okay, so that's the end of that one, yeah?
Okay.
Right, happy with that?
That was lovely. So that was RAID.
That was RAID, yeah. I'm really disappointed that this is not...
I'm always disappointed in you, but I've learned to just accept the disappointment. I think our viewers have now as well.
Oh, we might want to win it here.
What's that? Well, the fact that everything's healthy.
Everything's healthy. It just shows you what a great system builder I am.
Yeah, absolutely. You can't even break what you were... This rescan in progress. See, look, still super healthy. I think whatever you did was
great.
It's just bollocks. Right, so that's RAID. And
right,
that's
right.
And now we're going to do SNAS.
Yeah, so that was Software RAID. The next one we're going to have a look at is, as you mentioned, not many people actually use Software RAID.
Sure.
And what you could be using is some kind of NAS device. So what we're going to go through is some open source NAS devices, OpenFiler I've selected. And the benefits of a NAS device is you can take all of this storage and just take it off the server.
Mm.
So instead of having my file server with its local storage there, I can have my domain controller, and I can have a NAS box with all the files on it. And the benefits of your NAS box is, you know, often they're running a basic operating system that provides file level access to the clients.
Yeah.
And also, they've got lots of backup technology in them, so I can snapshot those disks every 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So I can always revert back to a different snapshot.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is let's set up...
You took a quick look at... FreeNAS was one that people were asking about. You weren't too impressed by it.
Well, FreeNAS, at the end of the day, what these NAS boxes do, free NAS, it's based on Linux.
Yep.
The idea is you can run it on an old desktop machine or some old machine with loads of disks in it, and you could provide a big file share to the network.
Yeah.
Now, if you're running at home, free NAS is fine. Free NAS will provide a Windows file level access, so that's SMB. It will provide Unix access, Apple file access, but what it doesn't provide is it doesn't allow it to be a nice SCSI target.
So it can't cluster with it?
Well, yeah, exactly. Now, for people at home, iSCSI you probably wouldn't use, but for some of you guys who want to use VMware to demo clustering and everything, OpenFile is really good, because what we'll show you next week is how to build a cluster using OpenFile in a VM, and you can see all the failover working and everything.
I'm not about next week.
No, but we're going to film it after this, aren't we?
That's the one.
So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to power this machine off. Let's get rid of that server. And just so you can see it as well, I'm just going to add a new virtual machine to this network. So team, add new virtual machine. And this virtual machine is going to be my Linux NAS box.
Okay.
So I'm just going to say it's...
Can't you choose a Linux? Oh, it falls under the other, does it?
Linux. I don't know what it's actually running, so I'm just going to say other Linux.
Right.
OpenFiler, we call this.
Oh, we're going to do some installing. We're going to install... I take it we're going to install
OpenFiler,
operating system.
Yeah. So use bridge networking, so everything else on the network can see it, so I'm happy with that one. Size 8 gigabytes. Again, if you go to OpenFiler or just stick into Google, I'm not overly sure what they're recommending for the installation.
Can't be anywhere near
8 gigs is going to be massive.
Way over the top.
So
I don't think a gig.
I'm just going to go with 8 on that anyway. So that's my OpenFiler one set up. Now, because it's going to be a NAS box, to emulate this, I'm just going to add into VMware some additional hard disks.
Ah, okay.
So a new virtual disk, fine, happy with that. Yeah. Let's add another one. New hard disk.
So we're going to give this 3 hard drives?
Yeah, we'll give it 3.
Or we're going to give it 4, one for itself and 3 additional.
It's actually got one already, so I'm just adding 3
additional.
Ah, these are
3 additionals, yes, of course.
So create new disk. And the next thing I'm going to do is just pop the OpenFiler ISO disk into the drive.
All fairly standard stuff with VM. We've covered this enough in our previous podcasts.
Now, you can download from OpenFiler, whatever the website is, a pre-made VM.
Oh, that's quite handy.
Yeah. But I thought I'd show you how to install it, because we're going to need to do something slightly non-standard.
Okay.
To get it working.
As part of the installation process?
Yeah. So what we're trying to do is get iSCSI working, and one of the benefits of iSCSI, just think about it, is SCSI over an IP-based network.
Okay.
So it enables a server to mount a SCSI volume that's on a NAS box somewhere, and that could be subject to snapshotting and loads of bits and pieces.
You're not going to have to type anything at the command line, are you?
Why are you getting worried now?
Well, we'll get told off.
Yeah. By the Unix beardy people.
That's right. So that's now just going through the process of installing. Is that going to take long, or is it worth our while?
We will do a speed up at some point, but it's not such a painful install. It's worth just taking you through.
Okay. This is quite early on. We deviate from the normal path.
Yeah, it's just doing a test of the app. Suddenly, you notice with Linux a lot, they test to see whether the application install's been tampered with.
Yeah, just to make sure that it's... as they intended.
Oh, excuse me.
What have you done?
I'm going to be a bit more graphical than this last time.
Yeah?
So with OpenFiler, it can just be a native file server for Windows machines, Mac machines. We set that up, but what we want to use it for is a nice SCSI target.
Okay. Does it have an interface to it, or is it all...
Yeah, once you install it on this, how you administer it is you administer it from a web browser.
Fantastic.
Yeah, we'll take you through the install, because you're going to need to give this thing a static IP address.
Okay.
Chiamo.
OpenFiler.
Do I full screen on it?
Sounds good to me.
Right, so next on this, we're obviously in England. You can tell we're in England because of the sad faces. Right, automatic partition. I don't know how this is going to partition it.
What's disk druid?
Partition. It's just seeing all the disks I've added, right. And it's just asking to initialize them. okay, so we can see the disks down the bottom. I can see 1, 2, 3 disks. This is going to be my operating system drive.
So
I need to create a new path. I've done this before. So again, with OpenFiler, there is online documentation for it. What I'm going to do is give it a a boot directory, and that's going to be on the first disk.
Okay.
It's weird the way this works. And again, the boot directory, I'm going to give a gig because I've got plenty of space. So 1,000 megabytes is good enough for me.
That's 1,000 megabytes in disk manufacturing terms.
Linux people are going to hate me, aren't they? Okay, even more so. The next thing I'm going to do is have a... Actually, we need to swap, don't we? And swap, I'm also
going to... No, you've got a VFAT.
Swap, and I think I'm going to give that 256. Doing okay.
So a bit more than a quarter of a gig.
And look what I've done. I've done it the wrong place.
Done it all wrong, have you?
Right, new. Not on B, not on C, not on D. It's a bit annoying you have to do that.
And how much are you going to give that?
And this is going to be swap.
Right.
And this is going to be 256.
Okay. So that's just you doing it right this time.
That's exactly. Yeah, and the rest of it, how much have I got left? 6,934.
Plenty.
It's going to be for root. 6,934.
Should all add up.
So again, all I'm doing is I'm making sure that those three disks are left totally empty for OpenFiler.
Yeah.
So all the OS is on the first drive. Right, let's just scroll through that. That looks all good. Click on next. And DHCP. Now, I don't want to give it... I don't want it to have an IP address from a DHCP server.
Because that could change every time.
Exactly. So what I want to do is give it a static IP of 250, we'll give it.
Is that a 255, 255, 255?
Yeah. Zero. So that's okay.
You didn't put the zero in.
I know. Just checking. And also we'll give it a gateway. I don't think this my NAS box needs to get onto the internet, but and the DNS server is just my domain controller and always use the same to 1.200. That's it. Click on next.
Cool.
So we're in London. Or Dublin, thereabouts. Root password.
So that's you've done all the setup now, and it's now going to actually deploy and install
that. I think that's the last bit I need to do. We can just sit back and watch it now.
Excellent.
I think.
Does it come with any games we can play whilst it's installing?
Don't think
Pac-Man
so, no.
Or Space Invaders?
No.
Nothing at all.
But I did buy Pac-Man on my iPod.
Oh, did you?
It was a waste of money.
Was it crap?
Yeah. Don't play games on iPods. It's rubbish.
You don't, or you wouldn't?
No, it just doesn't work. So I bought that. And after I realised it didn't work, I bought Texas Hold'em. Which I'm like, and then I bought Sudoku.
Okay. Like, and you still don't have like it?
Nah, it's just... Like,
so you're going to buy some more to prove the point?
Yeah, well, we don't have anything over here for your iPod, do we? No movies or anything?
Well, not
other than Pixar than short films.
I'm other than the ones you create yourself. Right.
Right, so next, and away we go.
I was reading a couple of forums that people have been talking about this on. It still amazes me that people still don't understand that podcasting is not a requirement to have a an iPod.
Really?
Yeah.
I was wondering how you watch our podcast, because you don't have an iPod, do you?
I don't, no. You didn't know that either?
No. I just thought,
you've got to have an iPod.
iPod, yeah.
Well, you don't. There you go. That teaches you that. Right, well, we'll be back shortly then.
Yeah, there we go.
We're back. Okay, so it's installed. And you can see, once you've installed OpenFilo, you can just leave it at this screen, and it's telling us how we can administer it. So because I gave it a static IP address, we can see it's just telling us to go to
that IP address.
On that port. Strange port, 446. Right, you're going to remember that, Nick?
Yeah.
Right, so what I'm going to do is just pop to another machine, i.e. the domain controller. I'll just full screen this as well. That didn't work out quite as I planned.
Do you want to just reuse that job serve window?
Right, I'm going to give myself a bit more screen area here. Thank you.
Right.
Okay, so just pop up a web browser and we're going HTTPS 192.168.1.250.
Yep.
Forward, what is it? 44. Oh, you can see. Not that I've done this before. /admin is what you want. Now, there's a problem with the certificate because the certificate was given to it by itself and this machine doesn't trust it, so.
You need to put it into the trusted.
You can do, or just ignore it. And accept the license.
The preamble.
Yeah, so quickly speed read that, yeah.
Jesus, you are quick reading.
I am good, yeah.
How do you know you haven't just agreed to give away your bank details?
Right, now the logon, it took me a while to realise this, but the logon, the default one, the username is OpenFiler and the password is just password, all right. Lowercase. So that's just the logon with that. And so of course you get a chance to change it afterwards. So what I'm expecting to see once we've logged on is we should see those three physical disks,
yep.
Or four, because it will also see its own disk as well.
Yeah.
Right, administer the storage device from here.
So I think this is a good thing about your podcast. They really can drag on, but you just pack them with so much good information that people love them.
I can't log on anymore.
Why?
I don't know.
Oh my god, given your current state of mind, I'm really worried you're going to start crying.
Oh, it's all going wrong.
No, it's the 1250, that's the IP address you need to be going to. That's correct.
Why can't I log on? Administer the storage device from here.
Yeah.
So I click on it, and we get nothing.
What did you do wrong?
I don't know.
I think this is what people like. They like the fact that it always goes wrong for us all the time with everything we do, whatever.
They're carefully staged.
That's it.
Right, so let's just...
That's why it's not recommended. Microsoft aren't letting you...
Open. File.
Filler.
Password. Don't do it again to me. Thank you.
There we go.
All right, there we go. So just close down the browser, open it up again.
Yeah.
Right, so what I'm going to do is just have a look at General first, the General tab. And we can see, at the moment, it doesn't know about any local networks. Now, the way OpenFiler works is it works based upon access control lists. So you can say what people have got what permissions to in what particular area. But it also works on IP address as well.
Okay.
So you can say, I only want this local network to trust this NAS box.
Okay.
So I'm going to type in local.
Which would make sense in environments where you want to just give it to groups of people.
Exactly, yeah. And the way we're planning to use it with their clustering is, in effect, I would only let that one machine, two machines.
Yeah, of course.
Access it, which will be those cluster nodes. So 1.0 and the subnet mask is just standard class C. And we'll just update that.
Cool.
Right, the other thing we can do is this does actually, OpenFiler does integrate with Active Directory. So it can go to Active Directory and it can pull a list of your groups. Mm-hmm. So you can easily assign permissions to groups from Active Directory to resources on this, which is pretty good.
And this is all free, by the way, isn't it?
All totally free, yeah. itidiots.com, the domain controller, you've got to tap in the IP address of the domain controller. ADS realm is lab.itidiots.com and we'll join the domain for you. And administrator password is our usual. And there's normally a little box there that says update. Oh, submit, here we go.
That one?
That's the one.
Blue.
So just doing a little bit of initial configuration, we still haven't set up any disks as yet. But let's have a look at the services, first of all, that this box can offer. So, SMB, Server Message Block, CIFS. Can't quite remember off the top of my head what that acronym CIFS stands for, but that's Windows File Sharing, so we can enable that. NFS version 3 for Unix hosts. You can allow people to access their files through a web interface via FTP. So there's many different ways of accessing it. What I want this to be as well is an iSCSI target. So I'm just going to enable those two things, SMB and iSCSI target.
Right.
So that's all the configuration done. I'm just going to have a look into accounts here just to see if it's pulled any users or groups from Active Directories yet.
It's really quite smart.
There we go. So it's pulled in a list of groups.
It's quite
already.
Smart, isn't it?
It's really nice, yeah.
And by default, they've all got access to this?
No, you have to define.
Right, okay, that's quite
It hasn't pulled in the users as yet. Right, so what I've got to do is click on general, no, sorry, volume, and create some volumes
okay.
for shares to exist in. Okay, so physical storage management first, we'll have a look at. So you can think of volume as the logical space we can actually use. And I can see all the drives I've got and the partitions on them, so not many partitions in these at all.
Okay, with the first one being the one that the operating system's on.
Yeah, so A's one with the operating system on, we can see B, C and D, are the next one's down. So I can go into software RAID management. And I can create a new RAID partition. And the way it actually works is a little bit strange. And if I wanted, for example, B, C, and D to be a mirror, I'd have to put RAID partitions on the first, and then I define the mirror afterwards. So let's have a quick play with that. I'll go to my B drive. And we shall create a RAID array member of 8 gig. By default it picks up the whole lot, so let's just create that.
So
I defined disk B as a RAID array member, or 8 gig of it is. And what I do is I did the same to C, and we should be able to mirror them.
So we can see it's there.
Back to list of physical storage devices.
And we're going to add in C now.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you need to add in D as well, so that you can get the RAID?
Well, it depends what level you want to go to. If you want to go to RAID 5, yeah, you would have to.
Oh, okay.
This does support RAID 10 as well, and RAID 6, which is parity across two physical disks.
Oh, okay.
I don't know so much more about it than that. Okay, so I'll just put an extended partition on that. So what... Oh, shit. Didn't want to do extended. I wanted to do RAID. that so ain't going to work, is it?
I don't think so. So you've now got one drive with 16 gig on it, if you extended the original.
If I extended one, but what I just did there, I think I made it extended, didn't I? Oh no, there we go.
Yeah, extended partition.
Yeah, I wanted it as RAID.
Yeah. So you want to delete it.
Quite clever you are, Nick, aren't you?
Oh, amazing like that. Got a gift for seeing the obvious. Apart from when it's staring me in the mouth. Right. Come on.
I could take... No, I'll stop that.
No, stop it. God, you said to me this was going to be snappy and punchy in 35
snappy
minutes.
Snappy and punchy. It's just... You keep on making mistakes.
No, keep making mistakes.
Right, so RAID array member. Great.
Agreeing to do a podcast with you might have been one of them. Come on. If you can have these big pauses, at least make them entertaining.
Pause.
Make them entertaining. I don't care. It's not your fault, but make them entertaining.
Look at the blue bar.
I'm bringing entertainment to this.
Right, so now if I go to software RAID management. So I've created my two physical drives. I put a RAID partition on each one.
Yep.
If I go to software RAID management now, we can see I can keep that striped and say I want these, or mirrored, I want those two to be part of it. It's a little bit funny sometimes. You notice that was greyed out. But
yeah.
It's Linux.
It's free. What do you want?
So are there any paid products that people use that rival this?
Yeah.
Why would people go with a paid product? again, hopefully I've got someone coming in, Mark, who's got much more understanding about the paid ones. He does
sounds.
The hardware-based things for our company, yeah.
Right.
So I'm not overly sure of the advantages, apart from you've got a semi-question, keeping all this storage on this open source product. I'm not having a go at the open source product or anything.
I wouldn't.
I know. But sometimes it's nice to buy support of someone, especially when you're talking about storage like this.
I see. So, okay, it's the old adage really then, isn't it?
Yep.
Peace of mind.
So we can see in there we've got a RAID 1 array, and notice it's given it a different one, MD0, in there.
And so if you refresh that, we'll see that synchronization processing probably will be complete by
I would imagine, yeah. Some problem. Shouldn't be doing that. It's really stressing this machine out, all the syncing, I guess.
Well, there we go. That's what we do.
Right. Let's go into create new volume next.
Go on, then.
I'm waiting.
Waiting for what?
Waiting for the blue thing to happen.
Because
what I want to do next, and just to speed this up a little bit, I'm going to create a new SCSI volume on it, and then we can see iSCSI connect to it, and then you'll see the benefits, and then we'll wrap up at that point. Right, so create a new volume group. We call this one Mirror. So that's going to be part of it. It's weird. Before you create a volume, they've got to be part of a volume group first.
Right.
You're losing interest, aren't you?
No, I'm just worried about the fact that our file sizes are normally about, 150, 170 meg, and people have difficulty downloading those sometimes. Imagine now, it's going to be like 300.
Okay, so we can create a volume, and I'm going to set this up for a clustering.
Okay.
So I'm going to use some strange terminology, which we don't know of as yet, so I'm going to call this one Quorum. And required space on this. Let's put a gigabyte.
It's not a gig.
Or 1,000 megabytes, roughly. Or 1,000 megabytes,
most exactly.
But a gig, roughly. But we can see down here the file system type. Now, these are various different file systems. Unfortunately, it doesn't support NTFS, which it doesn't matter because when your users or when your client machines are accessing it, they're not interfacing with that file system.
No.
But what it does mean is if you do have lots of files on an NTFS drive, it wouldn't be so easy to migrate it to this solution, whereas FreeNAS does give you that benefit.
Oh, okay.
But one of the things that FreeNAS doesn't offer you is the ability to offer iSCSI. iSCSI, okay. Yeah.
So SCSI was the better solution for you?
It was, and it's the only way we can use clustering. So let's put Quorum in there.
So there.
Okay, and we'll create a few more ones. Where's create? Create new volume. And this one will be called data. Data. And I'll put this one at exactly 3,000 megabytes. See what I did there, Nick?
Yeah, it's good, well done.
Right, and that would be iSCSI as well.
Okay. Why have you created two?
What I'm doing is I'm trying to do a little bit of preparation for when we do clustering. So creating three drives.
So that would be a shorter podcast because we won't have to go through all of this.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
So create new volume. And I don't really know what else we could put on here. Let's put data two.
Yes.
I didn't mean to have caps lock on there. And we'll put this 3,000 again. And that would be iSCSI.
Okay.
So the benefit of iSCSI again is I can host what the server is going to think of as local hard disks, local physical disks.
Yep.
So anything that we can do on those local physical disks, you'll be able to do with this iSCSI disk image, I suppose. Right, so that's all there. The next thing I'm going to do is just edit these and just have a look at the permissions on them. So the iSCSI Quorum box, if we just scroll down to the bottom, we can see at the moment, if you're coming from that network, it's going to deny you
access.
So I'm just going to put allow in there.
Okay.
And I'll just do that for Q, because this has probably been going on quite a while now, isn't it?
Who?
This part of this. Q. Okay, well, I'll do one more.
Only an hour.
Is it an hour? Okay, well, that would do. Let's have a look at the other side of things now. So back into my VMware. Let's come out of this.
I wonder if we could really cleverly make this two episodes.
Right, so I'm looking at VMware now.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at my domain controller. Mm. Now what I've done is I've gone and installed the client part of the SCSI software, or the iSCSI software, and that's called the SCSI Initiator. Now this is a free download from Microsoft's website. Okay.
Oh, okay.
So it's just a free download. So far we've got free NAS.
Yeah.
Or we've got OpenFiler. We set up a few SCSI volumes and now we're going to mount them on here.
Right.
Now I only actually set up one that would work.
Oh yes, yeah, we only did allow access for one of them, didn't we? Quorum.
So what I can do is load up the SCSI initiator on one of your client machines. I'm going to click on discovery and add in the IP address of my NAS box, 192.168.1.250.
And it's port 446.
That's actually the standard iSCSI port 3260.
That
was the admin port.
Okay.
You didn't know, you're stupid.
Shut up. I was just trying to make sure you didn't end up looking at something again, not knowing what you're doing.
So we can see, when I click on the next tab, targets, I can see, oh look, it's found out from this machine here, which I didn't name very well, the OpenFiler, that's the machine. It's found a volume there called Quorum. Okay. And what I'm going to do is just log on to that.
Sweet.
And say, automatically restore this connection when the system boots.
Okay.
You've got no idea what's coming next, have you now? No idea.
Well,
the nice thing now is to click on Manage.
You'll see a disk.
Let's go into Disk Management here. And I can see, oh, there's an unknown disk. I'm going to initialize disk number. I'm not going to convert it. I want this on basic. Oh, why did that do that for?
Well, there you go. I did know that I was coming.
Initialize disk. Right, new partition. Too quickly. Go to primary. And I'm going to just format it as Q for core.
And
what?
Nothing. Call it something else.
Right, do you understand what's going to happen in it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, so the nice thing is we've got our server running. It's got a physical, what it thinks is a physical disk, really that's a file on our NAS box. That NAS box gives us functionality like snapshotting every hour or snapshotting every 20 minutes.
Yep.
So at any point I can revert that hard disk back to any point or in the past, well, as long as it's within those 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Job done.
Job done. Jobs are good. And now the next thing we're going to do in the next episode, which I just can't wait to do, is going to be clustering, because now we've got our shared storage.
Let's wear exactly the same clothes next.
We will wear exactly the same clothes. Yeah. Now we've got our shared storage. We can point our two cluster node at that shared storage and see if we can get some clustering working. Remember, we're doing this just purely in VMware.
This is all virtual.
All done in virtual memory. And if you look on or Google it and just try and find out other ways of people getting a cluster working in VMware, this is better.
Yeah.
This is much better.
The internet will know our name.
Exactly. We're going to go down in history. We're going to go
down.
Okay. That's
right.
It. Bye.
Okay. See you guys next week.
See
Take care.
Bye.
Himself to sleep tonight on a huge